to the Defense and Aerospace Report. I'm Vago Maradian here at NASA's John C. Stennis Space Center in Mississippi, where we just experienced an RS-68A rocket engine test over here at Stennis's historic test complex B, where the Saturn V was developed in the 1960s for the Apollo program that put man on the moon. Our coverage here is our trip here, and coverage here is sponsored by Aerojet Rocketdyne, who is the maker of this engine. And we have with us the man who is the program manager of the RS-68 program, Walt Janowski. Walt, congratulations. Amazing test. Tell us a little bit about the RS-68 and especially what you guys were trying to accomplish here today.
Well, thanks very much. I'm glad you were here to be able to see that. That's very impressive. The RS-68 is the main propulsion for the Delta IV, and we hot fire every single engine prior to delivery, and this was one of those tests where we demonstrate that it's working perfectly before we deliver it to our customer.
Tell us a little bit about the RS-68, because it started as the RS-68. Now you're working on the RS-68A. The thrust has gone up by about 120,000 pounds to about 720,000 pounds of thrust, which is an enormous amount of thrust to be coming out of one engine that I'm estimating probably weighs, 2.5 tons or so, right? So that's an enormous amount of power coming out of a very tiny package. Talk to us about the history of the RS-68.
That's right. Yeah, the 68 was developed back in the late 90s for, the Delta IV rocket. A few years ago, the NRO decided they needed a heavier capability for larger payloads, and when they did their trades on making a different rocket, it was better just to upgrade the 68 to a 68A to give it a little bit more power, and that solved their problem, and so we're making 68As now.
You know, Tom Martin and Julie Van Cleek and I have been talking, and, a lot of the discussion is not necessarily about driving up performance at this point, but driving down cost to take cost and complexity out of the program. What are some of the challenges that presents, especially for a rocket engine that has to have pretty much a zero defect approach to it by the time it gets on the launch vehicle?
Yeah, sure. No, it's an extremely complicated device. So you have multiple systems that have to interact, perfectly with each other. The engine has to react perfectly with the vehicle or with the test stand here in this case. So having the experience to be able to know how all the parameters need to fall out and the inlet and start conditions, extremely critical to making it a successful test and making it a successful system to operate for the duration, and it operates perfectly every time when you need it. So.
What's the challenge, though, of taking complexity and cost out of the program? You have a winning design, you know what works. How is it you guys are experimenting and tweaking to try to, because the customer has made it abundantly clear that they are extremely cost-focused and are willing to go with guys who, from the heritage perspective is a little bit risky, from their perspective it's innovative and fresh and new. But how are you guys making some of those trade-offs and balances?
Oh, it's definitely a risk assessment. Certainly you can take advantage of a lot of new materials and techniques, and when you're starting a new engine from scratch, it's extremely valuable to do that. You've got a very mature product like this, you have to be very careful about what you change, because you've spent a lot of effort in certifying the engine and proving it over multiple flights. So we do that very carefully. I mean, it takes a lot of engineering experience to know exactly what can you change and what you cannot.
As you look at what the growth pattern is for the RS-68, now the A, what are you guys looking at, and how much more power do you think you can get out of this core sort of successful design?
Well, there's certainly capability still available. What we hope to do is be able to get an additional order so that the Delta IV Heavy can continue into the future, and we have more orders for large type satellites, either for the NRO or for other customers that would demand that kind of power.
So in decades of doing one of the coolest jobs in the world, what are some of the core, what are Walt's top three lessons?
Oh, we always hire good people. You want to be able to have a good deep experience base, because you never know what next issue is going to come up, or you're going to see something in the data that you need to analyze, and you have to have a real good bench, a lot of bench strength to be able to analyze that and know that you've got a very safe product. That's really the top one there.
And what would you put as a close second? Measure twice.
Definitely your processes that you've developed over all those years captures all that experience, and you really have to have a strong dedication to detail, attention to the small things that could really give you a bad day if you don't.
And so tell me, I would imagine, though, Walt is also a vintner in his own right. He's a winemaker, living in the California. I mean, I don't know how much better than that you can get. You design rocket engines and you make wine living in California. That's not really a bad deal. Tell us a little bit about what winemaking and rocketry have in common, aside from, obviously, patience.
No, well, that's really it. You know, once you plant the vineyard, it's 3 to 4 years before you can have a crop in order to do anything with. And so you really have to have the patience and look to the future many years down the road and know that that investment is going to pay off into something valuable.
Do you have your own house label wine at this point? I mean, can viewers like send you a check and start ordering wine?
No, I need a license for that. It's strictly a home kind of operation where I trade with others and happily share it with all my friends.
Walt, thanks very, very much. Best of luck on the program, and thanks so much. Really, really incredible thing to see.
Thank you.